So from Chicago, Perkins moved to Philadelphia, and it wasn't school teaching anymore. She took a job with the Philadelphia Research and Protective Association, one of these great associations that were popping up all over the country during the Progressive Era. It was a classic Progressive Era reform group. It worked directly with the city's poor while also conducting research. So Perkins is doing her studies and her reports, but she one of her jobs is also to go down to the docks and meet women there, including many African-American women coming from the South and immigrant women, and intercepting them before they could be lured off into prostitution. One day, as she recalled, two men who didn't appreciate her efforts followed her home, and she had to fight them off by yelling and swinging an umbrella at them. So that was Philadelphia. Perkins had her eyes opened, and you know, she was living in both parts of the city. You know, she was with the poor people, she was down by the docks, but she also spent time with some of the city's wealthiest people, raising money from them in homes that, as she put it, had marble steps that a maid wipes off every morning, which was as much of an eye-opener for her as the poverty, because, as I said, she grew up very middle class. But while she's in those marble-stepped homes, she's also in the, you know, grittiest parts of the city, and she wrote into her Mount Holyoke alumni magazine that 10-cent lodging houses, employment agencies, the offices of the Philadelphia political gang, and the two police courts all became my haunts. So from Philadelphia, she comes here to New York. She took a job with the Consumer League and becomes their expert on factory safety, an important issue at the time because immigrant workers were being crammed into dangerously overcrowded garment factories and other factories around the city. She was already one of the city's foremost authorities on factory safety in 1911 when the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire occurred. By chance, Perkins was visiting a friend in a townhouse on Washington Square Park at the time, and the butler came and said, there seems to be a fire, and Perkins and other people rushed out, and she actually was there, standing there watching as many of the 146 women who died jumped to their death. It made a huge impression on her, and it also, she would later say that the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire was a torch that lighted up the whole industrial scene. Suddenly, the issues she had cared about very deeply were major city issues and even national issues. Now, with the torch lighting up the scene, Perkins provided a great deal of the light. She was the advisor to two state commissions that investigated the fire, and she was instrumental in developing the reforms that emerged, including things like fire escapes and sprinklers. Through her factory safety work, Perkins got to know a state legislator who headed one of the investigations, Al Smith. When Smith became governor of New York, he appointed Perkins to be on the State Labor Commission, one of the commissioners. And in 1928, Smith runs for president, and when he loses, Franklin Roosevelt is elected governor. Roosevelt gave Perkins a promotion, making her the state industrial commissioner, so she runs the entire state labor department. It was in Albany during Roosevelt's governorship that the Roosevelt-Perkins alliance began. Perkins prodded FDR to take more progressive stands and to do more for workers and poor people. When the stock market crashed in 1929, Perkins headed up a commission that recommended that New York State establish an emergency relief program and public works programs to help the unemployed, which the state did. In a very real way, the New Deal got started right here in New York during that governorship. So after Perkins and FDR had their conference in this townhouse, after she accepted the job of labor secretary, she moved to Washington, D.C., and the New Deal began. The work that they had started in New York was going national. The Roosevelt I Knew tells the story of how it came about. It's an unusual book. It is, as Perkins says right at the outset, biased in Roosevelt's favor. But if it is biased, it is not by much. One of the book's unexpected virtues is how honest it is about Roosevelt's shortcomings and flaws, much more so than might be expected from such a close associate. Perkins was anything but a sycophant. She was constantly pointing out when Roosevelt disappointed her. In some cases, she did this right to his face. Perkins liked to tell the story of when Roosevelt was elected governor, and he offered her that job of industrial commissioner to run the Labor Department. If she accepted, she would have gone from being one member of the industrial board, which Smith had appointed her to being chief executive of a state labor department with 1,600 people reporting to her. And the fact that she was a woman made this, you know, quite amazing. So Roosevelt argued when he was offering her the job what a great advance this would be for women if she accepted. But Perkins refused to congratulate him for being forward-looking. It was more of a victory for Al to bring himself to appoint a woman never appointed before, she told Roosevelt, than it is for you, who, when I have a record as a responsible public official for almost 10 years, you know, is appointing me to this job. So, you know, she was, as I say, not really the flattering type. In the Roosevelt I Knew, Perkins is similarly flinty in her assessment of Roosevelt. At the beginning, she describes him as a young man who is haughty and, quote, uncompromising. And she recalls, unhappily, her early years as a lobbyist for the Consumer League in Albany, when she was desperately trying to get the first state law passed that would have some kind of maximum hours. It was a maximum hour law for women, the 54-hour bill. And she recalled that she could not talk FDR into coming out and endorsing it. But she also talks about how he evolved over time from a self-absorbed young man who seemed to constantly be looking down his nose at people to a compassionate leader who was ideally suited for America's darkest hours. Perkins is also direct in her assessment of Roosevelt's intellectual limits. She was always very clear that he had many strengths, but it wasn't always in understanding the details of the policy. And she talks about how when British economist John Maynard Keynes came to the White House in 1934, he left saying that he had, quote, supposed the president was more literate, economically speaking. So she's honest about the downsides, but if she is, she's just as insistent about his many strengths. She really did like the guy. The book shows Roosevelt as being highly involved in putting together the New Deal, and in particular in navigating the political challenges of enacting a progressive legislative agenda. There's a fine description in the book, for example, of how he stage managed the Social Security Act. One of the best things about the book is the personal glimpses it provides of Roosevelt, glimpses she had access to because she was there to observe so much. She was the only she and Ickes were the only two cabinet members to serve for Roosevelt's entire presidency, and then she had been with him during his governorship. So really no one served at a higher level more closely than she did for Roosevelt's career. One of these glimpses, she mentions that the federal minimum wage law, which of course had huge, huge importance and still does today, got its start when FDR was reelected in 1936, at a time when the Supreme Court was, many of you will recall, not very into this New Deal social legislation. And FDR turned to her after the election and said to Perkins, "What happened to that nice unconstitutional bill you had tucked away?" And they got to work on it. Perkins' assessment of Roosevelt is in many ways objective and dispassionate, like that editorial in the Survey, the social work magazine that she was once compared to. But her feelings about Roosevelt were warm enough that in the end, she injects some uncharacteristic emotion in her assessment. And I can tell you, as someone who's read many of her letters and read much of what she said about people, that she did feel deeply, but she didn't express it so often. So in the final chapter of The Roosevelt I Knew, after she's talked about public works and Social Security, is called Last Months. In it, she recalls very sadly Roosevelt's final illness and death. Now, as I mentioned, by 1944, Perkins was not the most popular member of the cabinet. There were loud voices in the press and in Congress calling for her ouster. Collier's was asking what she was still doing in office. Perkins actually repeatedly offered to resign so he could choose someone less controversial, but he turned her down each time. And as Perkins relates in this chapter, Last Months, he said to her, "I can't think of anybody else, and I can't get used to anybody else." He then thanked her and, in a voice, as she says, quote, filled with exhaustion, told her, "Frances, you've done awfully well. I know what you have accomplished." Perkins was moved deeply. They both, she recalled, had tears in their eyes.